ಕೊಯ್ಲಿ ನಡುವೆ ತನಿತ್ತುವಾನ ವಾಸಮಾಯಿರುಕೀರ ಉಮರೆ ಸುಂದರಮಾನ ಮಂದೆಯಾಗಿಯ ಉಮ್ಮೋಡಯ ಜನತೆ ಉಮರೆ ಕೋಲಿನಲ್ಮೆ ತೊರುಳೋ ಉಮರೆ ಕೋಲಿನಲ್ಮೆ ತೊರುಳೋ ಉಮರೆ ಕೋಲಿನಲ್ಮೆ ತೊರುಳೋ ಉಮರೆ ಕೋಲಿನಲ್ಮೆ ತೊರುಳೋ
The caption for this morning meditation is The Matrix of Life. I don't know how you understand the word matrix. It is the originating point or the chamber in which something originates. So we are going to study about the matrix of life, the point where our real life originates. One day, a great scholar of the law, he met the author of law. Jews are very intelligent people, and the maximum number of Nobel Prizes are won by Jews, and the second one is no match to number one. So these Jews are very intelligent people, highly intellectuals, and many scientists have come out of this Jewish community. So this scholar of the law, he must have been a very intelligent man, very intellectual man, well informed man. He came to Jesus. Probably at that time he didn't know that Jesus was the author of the law. Jesus was a rabbi coming up, and people are unable to understand some of the utterances of Jesus. They are different from what they traditionally thought. So this man of letters came to our Savior, and we read a dialogue between these two great heads, a dialogue between the author and the law scholar. We read this passage in Luke chapter 10 from verse 25 to 37. So in those days it was customary for these scholars to have debates, to have dialogues, to ask questions. At times they may not be very serious to find answer, but they were very much interested in these type of academic forums. So this man asked Jesus a question: Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? And in the Bible, at least there's one more record of another scholar, a lawyer, coming asking Jesus the same question: what should I do to inherit eternal life? They must be discussing this question with one another. So here we see two great giants, but one is not a match to the other, but a scholar and the author, they are discussing something very vital, a topic about eternal life. That's why I call this the matrix of life. Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? The answer to this question was an answer from Jesus. Jesus said, what is written in the law? How readest thou? So he asked a question, answer to that question, Jesus asked a question. So this man said, what is written in the law? But he didn't stop with that. He asked another question. Who is my neighbor? Who is my neighbor? Jesus told him a story and asked him, which now of these three thinkest thou was neighbor unto him that fell among the thieves? So after telling a story, Jesus asked a question as an answer to the question. My dear brother, my dear sister, answers to these questions really constitute the matrix of life. What is after all life? How the life originates? The answers to these questions constitute the matrix of life. We'll go to Luke chapter 10, verse 25 to 37. And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tempted Jesus, saying, Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? It's not that he wanted to know how he should inherit eternal life. He just wants to know what Jesus would say about it. Jesus said unto him, unto the lawyer, what is written in the law? How readest thou? And the lawyer answering said, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy strength, and with all thy might, and thy neighbor as thyself. And Jesus said unto him, thou hast answered right. Your answer is right. This is the way that you can inherit eternal life. This do, and thou shalt live. This do, thou shalt live. Not only will inherit eternal life, ye shall have a life worth living. So he talked about a life that is after, but Jesus talked about a totality of a life, a life that is not cut off. Here also you'll have a wonderful life, and you shall live forever. But the lawyer, willing to justify himself, he asked a question, who shall inherit eternal life? Probably he wants to say that nobody will inherit eternal life. So he wants to ask another question. Okay, who is my neighbor? Who is my neighbor? Father Jesus told him a story. And Jesus answering said, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment and wounded him, departed, leaving him half dead. And by chance there came down a certain priest that way. When he saw him, he passed by on the other side. And likewise a Levite, when he was at the place, came and looked on him and passed by on the other side. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was. And when he saw him, he had compassion on him and went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring in oil and wine, and set him on his own beast, and brought him to an inn, and took care of him. And on the morrow, when he departed, he took out 2 pence, and gave them to the host, and said unto him, take care of him, and whatsoever thou spendest more, when I come again, I will pay thee. After telling this story, Jesus asked that scholar a question, which now of these three, that priest, that Levite, the Samaritan, which now of these three thinkest thou was neighbor unto him that fell among the thieves? And he that showed mercy on him. Probably he didn't want to just say the word the Samaritan. Utterly why? But he said one who showed mercy on him. For that Jesus said, go and do thou likewise. Go and do thou likewise. So there we see five important questions. I call the first question prime question. Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? We are going to live forever and ever. He passed away, they say. Where has he passed away? Where has he gone? His life left him. Where did he leave? Where has his life gone? There is a life after death. It is certain. Where will we live? In what form we will live? Or will we born again like a monkey or a donkey or an ant or a peacock? How were we earlier? How are we going to be? Will this birth cycle stop? Have you ever seen anybody whose birth cycle stopped? Can I say that my birth cycle will stop with this birth? There are $1 million questions. What is life after? My dear brother, my dear sister, what should I do for that? Many people ask this question. Every religion asks this question. They went to Uttarakhand. Why? They want to seek the blessings of God. They are religious people. They are pious people. They want God's blessing. They want to inherit eternal life. Somebody told me, in Uttarakhand there is a bull. And if we just go and hold the tail of the bull, we could go to heaven. They believe. Somehow, either holding the tail of a bull, we should go to heaven. I'm not questioning their faith, but I want to draw your attention to their desire. What shall I do to inherit eternal life? I came into this world, I don't know what I was before. I'll be leaving this world. Where will I? I don't know. There is a story how Christianity came to England when they were tribal people. The monks from Rome, they went to these British Isles and they are going round and round and round those islands. And they were unable to communicate because they didn't know their languages. But those people in the British Isles, they were very beautiful. So these monks called them angelos. They are like angels. That is how the word English came. The Christian monks from Rome, when they went to England, when they saw these beautiful people, they called them angels, so the word English came. So the tribal king, they called these monks and he wanted to know what was the message these monks have got. He didn't know their language, they could not communicate with him, but the minister in their tribal court, he knew the language of these Roman monks, but probably he was unable to communicate, he was unable to explain everything what these monks had in their mind. At that time, a sparrow flew across the court. So the minister asked the king, King, did you notice a sparrow flying through the court? He said, yes. King, do you know from where it came? He said, I don't know. King, do you know where has it gone? Oh, I don't know. How do I know? These people have got an answer for that. From where it came and where has it gone? These people have got an answer for that. This is how they say Christianity is introduced to England, to the British Isles. My dear brother, my dear sister, many people have these questions. Once a certain lawyer went to Jesus, that we read in Luke chapter 18, verse 18. What shall I do to inherit eternal life? He was a leader, he was a ruler. And in Acts chapter 2 verse 37, on the day of Pentecost, the people asked Peter and the other apostles, "Sirs, tell us, what shall we do? What shall we do now? Tell us, what shall we do?" And we read in Acts chapter 16, the jailer, when he saw that miracle, he asked immediately Paul and Silas, "Sirs, what shall I do to be saved? What shall I do to be saved? What shall I do to inherit eternal life?" This question must be in the heart of every brother, every sister, every man who is born on the face of the earth. He must have this vital question, and he must have an answer to this question. What shall I do to inherit eternal life? Should I shave my hair? Should I give food to 1,000 people? Should I wear sackcloth? Should I go to pilgrim center? Should I sleep on nail bed? What shall I do to inherit eternal life? My dear brother, my dear sister, whatever we do, if I feed 1,000 people, is that enough that I can inherit eternal life? If I just sleep on the nail bed, is it enough for me to inherit eternal life? If I just go to the pilgrim center, is that enough for me to inherit eternal life? That lawyer knew that it is not enough. I can't do anything to inherit eternal life. All my righteousness are nothing but filthy rags. I cannot do something and say that because of this and that I can inherit eternal life. He wanted to know an answer for this very big life question. What shall I do to inherit eternal life? You must have this question, and you must have an answer for this question. So this is the matrix in which life originates. Answer to this question is the originating point of life. So Jesus asked him, as an answer to the question, what is written? I call this a principal question. The basis for an answer is the Word of God. What is written? What is written? What is that you read in the Bible? My dear brother, my dear sister, to show that Jesus is the Messiah, the promised Savior, in ever so many places in the Gospel, you read this phrase, "as it was written." He was born in Bethlehem, as it was written. He was taken to Egypt, as it was written. He was brought up in Nazareth, as it was written. He started his ministry on the shores of Galilee, as it was written. The miracles were taking place, the blind saw, the lepers healed, the lame walked, the deaf heard, the dumb spoke. Everything happened in his ministry as it was written. He went to Jerusalem on a colt, as it was written. He was betrayed by his own disciple, as it was written. Everybody forsook him and ran away, as it was written. He was judged, as it was written. He was slapped, as it was written. They slapped the judge. It was written in the book of Micah. As it was written, he was slapped. He was scourged, and his body became a type of like a plowed field, as it was written. His beard was plucked, as was written. His own people handed him over to the Gentile, as it was written. Everything happened in the life of Jesus as it was written. Justice was taken away in his case, as it was written. He was counted with the manly factors as it was written. They cast lots on his garment as it was written. They drew nails on his feet and hands as it was written. He pierced the sword on his side as it was written. He was buried in the sepulchre of a rich man as it was written. He rose again from the dead as it was, as he himself said. He ascended into heaven, sent his Holy Spirit and built his church as it is written. He'll come back as it is written. My dear brother, my dear sister, everything that happened in the life of Jesus as it was written. It was not only in the life of Jesus, even in our life, as it is written. What is in the Bible? There's a dispute between husband and wife. What does the Bible say? What does the Bible say? My dear brother, my dear sister, there was a dispute between a husband and wife who should prepare the coffee in the morning. He said, it's only wife should do it. It's the duty of a woman. My mother, I have seen, my grandmother, I have seen, they only prepare the coffee. She said, no, you see what is written in the Bible. He said, about making coffee, it is written in the Bible. He said, page after page after page, it's written in the Bible. Go read your Bible. He said, what is written in the Bible? The Bible says, he brews, not she brews. Only you should brew the coffee. It is he brews, not she brews. I'm not just saying that you have to see the Bible for that, but in your life situation, in bringing up your children, when disappointments come, when troubles surround you, see what is in the Bible. Like Noah, you are in an ark, rocked in water, not knowing what's going to happen. The window that was not shut, the door that was shut is not opened. You don't know what the future holds for you. Read in the Bible what happened the days of Noah. How God remembered Noah. How he sent an answer to Noah on the wings of a dove. My dear brother, my dear sister. So, want to inherit eternal life? To find an answer to this question, Jesus asked a question, what is written? And question number three, I call that paramount question. It is not just to read what is in the what is written. See, here we see, how readest thou? The letter kills, the spirit quickeneth. It is not just what is written, but how do you read that? It is not what you read, how do you read? How do you interpret? The word how in Greek, pos, P-O-C, pos. It means in what manner, in what way, in what manner, in what way you read it. My dear brother, my dear sister, a spiritual interpretation for what we read is very, very essential to inherit eternal life. So to inherit eternal life, it is not enough we read the Bible, it is more important how we read the Bible to suit our own convenience, just against our own culture, our own likes and dislikes, to our own taste. We won't understand the Bible as God wants us to understand it. So this is very, very important. We understand the Bible as God wants us to understand it. That's fascinating. And the Bible in its totality, not just taking one verse here, one verse there, and interpreting that out of context. Now, for what Jesus said that? Why did he use that illustration? What is the core of that? What is the purpose of it? How do we read that? We read about the story, we generally call the prodigal son, or the born again son. the returned son, whatever you may call it. So Jesus talked about the lost sheep, the lost coin, and the lost son. How the lost sheep was found by the shepherd, how the lost coin was found by the woman, and how the lost son returned home, and how the father received him. Likewise, God is willing to receive the people, those who go back to him. The father's love, the shepherd's care, that woman's concern. When Jesus was explaining that story in a beautiful way, somebody would take a thread from somewhere and say, she said that father, in that story Jesus said, gave a ring to the son, so it is not important to have jewels. It is not important, it's nothing wrong if you wear rings. Now that story, that parable is not for having a jewel or not having a jewel. So interpreting it out of context, just to argue out their own conviction. My dear brother, my dear sister, sometimes people go to an extent. I remember once one preacher said that Good Samaritan was for a Tamilian. And they asked, why do you call him a Tamilian? He said, yes, he was binding up the wounds. He bound the wounds of that victim. And a Jew cannot tear his dress, or a Samaritan cannot tear his dress and bind the wounds. He must have been wearing dhoti. That's why I thought he was a Tamilian. This is not the way that we read the Bible. What God wants to tell me, Bible is the written form of God's mind. It is the written form of God's mind. What God wants me to do, what God wants me not to do, what are the things God wants to give me. That's why Paul, when he was writing to Timothy, he says, I'm writing this to you that you may know how you ought to behave in the house of God. That you might know how you ought to behave, how you ought to behave. What we can do, what we should not do. Yesterday I was talking to one brother. I said, how important it is to observe the Lord's Day. How do I read that? How do I read that? Do I read that as a Pharisee could read it? Do I read that as a law scholar could read it? Do I read that as a scribe would read it? Or do I read that as a Christian would read it? Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not commit adultery. So there was a man, he loved a woman. He wanted to obey the word of God. He didn't want to commit adultery. So he killed the husband and took the wife. I didn't commit adultery. I only killed that man. She became a widow. Then I took her. Oh, you committed murder. Oh, the Bible says God is willing to forgive us. God's mercies are wonderful. So God will forgive me. I just committed a murder, God will forgive me. I asked God to forgive me. That's what somebody said. Many people don't understand the prayer of Jesus. Jesus prayed, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. And they said probably Jesus would pray, Father, don't forgive them. They know what they do. My dear brother, my dear sister, it's not that playing with Bible words. We are trying to understand God's mind. Can I understand God's mind through my intellect? How do I read this? It is only the Spirit of God must be able to explain, reveal to me what God's mind is. So the third question, what Jesus asked that man, how do you read it? How readest thou to inherit eternal life? It's very, very important. So that man answered and said, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy strength and with all thy mind, and thy neighbor as thyself. That was not just a very difficult answer. Because all Jews knew it. In Deuteronomy chapter 6 verse 5, the same thing the Lord revealed through Moses. It was a Mosaic law. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart and with all thy soul and with all thy strength. And the second part is found in Leviticus 19:18. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. It is not something what Jesus of Nazareth brought as a new teaching. It is in the Old Testament. This is God's mind. Now here we see how the scholar understood that and how the author understood that. How the scholar understood that, love God, love your neighbor. How the scholar, how that Pharisee, how that priest, how that Levite, how that scribe, how that Jew understood that, how Jesus understood that. There we see the matrix of eternal life. There we see the matrix of eternal life. It has got only two parts: love God and love your neighbor. You want to go to heaven? Some people want to have a dip in holy waters. Some people go to a pilgrim center. Some people want to have a charity endeavor. Some people want to fulfill the doctrines of Christianity. They want to be baptized. They want to take confirmation. They want to go to the church regularly. They want to pay their tithes. They don't want to speak lies. They want to keep up the Ten Commandments. What shall I do to inherit eternal life? Only two things, brother, sister. Love God. Love your neighbor. In Matthew chapter 22, we read from verse 35 to 40, another lawyer. When we say lawyer in the New Testament, it's a scholar. It is not a lawyer who takes a wakalat in the court. This lawyer is one who interprets law to the common people. Most of them are priests. Almost every lawyer, every priest was a lawyer, a Bible scholar. Because the Bible says they will seek the word of God on the lips of a priest. So the priest must be able to give the right interpretation to the word of God. So almost every priest was a lawyer. We don't know whether this lawyer was a priest or not. But it is not necessary that every lawyer is a priest. Every priest might have been, it is expected every priest to be a lawyer, but every lawyer doesn't need to be a priest. So another lawyer came to Jesus, scholar came to Jesus. He asked Jesus, what is the greatest commandment? So Jesus said the same thing. Love God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, with all your strength. Love your neighbor as thyself. There is no other commandment greater than this. All laws, all prophecies are contained in these two laws. Love God, love your neighbor. My dear brother, my dear sister, in those days, they write these two verses, Deuteronomy chapter 6, 5, Leviticus 19:18, and in small leather boxes, something like our tithe, they will tie those boxes around their forehead or on their hand. They are keeping these two verses always with them. Every Jew is expected to say this at least twice in a day. I love the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my strength, with all my mind, and I love my neighbor as myself. My dear brother, my dear sister, from the time I knew that it is expected of a Jew to say that at least twice a day, I started saying this more than twice in a day, because I know my righteousness must be more than the righteousness of a Jew. He must remember these two verses at least twice a day, minimum twice a day in your life. To love God with all our strength, with all our mind, with all our might, with all our soul, and to love our neighbor as ourselves. It should be tied on our forehead. It should be worn on your sleeves. My dear brother, my dear sister, it's very easy to at least academically know what is loving God. Loving God, you should do it with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind, our mindedness. Heart speaks about your emotion. Heart is the seat of emotion. It is not that you love God. You love God with a love emotion. When you think about God, that sweet emotion of love should flow. There is a beautiful Tamil song. A devotee sings about its deity, his deity. Ullamellam urugudaiya. Ullamellam urugudaiya me nenaikkayile. That is loving God with all of our heart. Our heart should melt. When you think about your son, when you think about your daughter, when you think about your grandchildren, your hearts melt. It is not because they have given a lollipop to you. It is not because they bought a new clothes for you. It is not because they are sending money to you. It's your child. Your heart melts. That is loving God. It is not God has done something. I don't have time to explain the whole thing. Loving God with all our heart. Our heart is for God. My dear brother, my dear sister. The bride says, the king brought me into his chambers. I rejoice in him. The king has brought me into his chambers. I am not rejoicing in the chamber, in his chamber. I rejoice in him. That is the love of the heart. I rejoice in him. A husband has taken the wife to a beautiful resort, or he bought a beautiful house for his wife. A beautiful house with a lovely lawn, with a rose garden, with a tennis court, with a swimming pool. And she said, "Honey, this house is for you." Now we can see two types of wives. One is rejoicing in the house the husband has given for her. One is rejoicing in the husband. The husband is coming from a Gulf country. He sent, "I bought a beautiful necklace for you. A diamond studded necklace with platinum chains. I bought this for you. I am bringing it to you." And she is looking forward to getting that necklace. He came from the airport, fully tired. As soon as he came in, she said, "Oh, you are very lovingly have brought that necklace for me. Just I want to see your love gift." He was too tired to give. Nevertheless, he wanted to give that to her. She just took the necklace in. She put it around her neck, against the mirror. Very beautiful. She came. He said, "Oh, thank you very much." She hugged him. She kissed him. One wife. There was another wife. She knew that he has brought a necklace. It is for her. But she received him. She hugged him, she kissed him. He was just opening his bag to get the necklace. He said, no, wait. "I've got some nice mint, lime, fusion, a cocktail, a drink, a juice for you. Just have a sip of it. Relax, have a bath, come. Then I can see the necklace. Where will it go? First have a bath and come." She knew the necklace is there. My dear brother, my dear sister, many a time we rejoice in God's salvation, we rejoice in God's gift, we rejoice in the peace God gives us, the job God gives us, we rejoice over everything we receive from God. But there is another love, rejoicing in God. That is the loving God with all our heart, with all our emotion. When we think about God, a love emotion should flow. Then with all our soul, that's the seat of behavior. Every move in our life should be the reflection of His love. Why I dress like this? Because I love God. I don't want to dress in a way He doesn't like me. Yeah, you're 100 years old. You got a child now, just born 8 days. Why do you want to remove its foreskin? With a sharp stone, the child might die. The pain will be excruciating. Why do you want to inflict the pain on the child? Why do you behave like this? My God wants. If you love God, you will obey His commandments. My Jesus said. Why do you want to remove your jewels? Why do you behave like this? The Bible says, I want to do something that would please my God. I'm not worried what my friends would say about me. I'm not worried what my relatives would tell about me. I'm worried what my Jesus would say. I just want to do what it pleases my Lord. A checklist. What is the perfect will of God concerning me? What is good for me? What is God's like? What's God's delight? If I shave my hair, if that delights God, I want to do it. If I want to have a beard and that would make my God rejoice, I want to have that. If I want to paint my face black and put dots all over, and if that could please my God, I want to do it. I'm not worried what the world would think. My Lord doesn't want me to do anything that will bring shame to me. That is loving God with all your soul. Your behavior, your likes, your dislikes. Why do you like this? My God likes it. Why don't you like this? My God doesn't like this. I don't have any other bigger answer than this. That is loving God with my soul, with all my strength. If I praise God, I praise God with all my strength. If I minister to God, I minister to God with all my strength. My dear brother, my dear sister, you may not like me saying this, and also you may not understand me saying this. This morning, unusually, I was too tired even to stand. My wife saw me. Extremely tired. But I was happy within, saying, Lord, if this could be my last sermon that I would ever preach, help me preach in a way that I am preaching my last sermon. I want to do my best. If the Lord would give me grace, I should ascend to heaven either on my heels or on my knees. On my knees when I am talking to Him, on my heels when I am talking about Him. Maybe I may not be very worthy to have this aspiration, but I do aspire. My dear brother, my dear sister, whatever you do, do it to your strength. Let come what may. When you want to give, give with all your might. When you want to sing, sing with all your might. When you want to minister unto Him, minister unto Him with all your might. The Lord must be able to be a witness. He has done His best. He has given His best. I have to do what the best I can do. My dear brother, my dear sister, with all my mind, with all my mind, I must have a reasoning also. What are all the things God has done for me? Who is this God? How much great His love is? I judge, I weigh, what is right, what is wrong. My love is not just a blind emotion. My love is not, my behavior is not conditioned by some blind love. I do my all my best to God, not again because of a blind love. I give my mind to it. Not a reprobate mind, not a vain mind, a spiritual mind. My discretion, a discretionary power. I discreet why I should love God. I can go on and on and on, but just I can find loving God is with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind. If you love God, in John 5:3, the Bible says, you will obey His commandments. So it's a question whether a Christian, a school of thought, they would say, oh, Christianity is, it's a doctrine based one. You should take baptism. You should pay your tithes. You should go to the church regularly. You should, if you don't attend the Sunday service, you won't go to heaven. There won't be a Christian funeral for you. You have to fulfill these requirements. That is Christianity. Some people say, no, Christianity is not that. Christianity is social service. Love your neighbor. Jesus said, love your neighbor. That's Christianity. What is Christianity? Christianity is loving the word or loving the world. Christianity is loving the word or loving the world. Some people say Christianity is loving the word. Some people say Christianity is loving the world. So it's a question whether Christianity is loving the word or loving the world. I want to tell you, brother, sister, Christianity is loving the world because you love the word. Christianity is loving the world based on the word. If you obey, if you love Him, you will obey His commandments. Now a difficult situation comes. What is loving my neighbor? Loving God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, with all by your strength. Okay, Lord, I understand. But what is loving my neighbor? Wait, what is difficulty in it? What is difficulty in it? Because in those days, the Jews, the religious leaders, were unable to understand, were unable to interpret who a neighbor was. So the rabbis had a difficulty in understanding or interpreting who a neighbor was. So they didn't know how to interpret loving the neighbor himself. So to justify himself, because it's very difficult. He has got an interpretation. I'm sure Jesus would give another interpretation. Another rabbi would give another interpretation. Many times we may not find a definition. We may not be able to define a word. Once the two groups of scholars, they were on a dispute, a dialogue, an argument in a forum, whether we can define every word or we cannot define every word. One school said, no, we can define everybody, every word is definable. Another group said, no, no, we cannot define a word. Word can be only experience, word cannot be defined. They were arguing. So those who believe that words cannot be, every word cannot be defined. So one scholar asked a question to the other team, can you define a dog? Can you define a dog? So this team, they were trying their level best, putting their heads together to see how they can define a dog. Somebody said, it'll have four legs. They said, no, many animals have got four legs. What can we say? Okay, it has got a tail. They said, all animals have got a tail. Now, how to define a dog? He said, no, it will bark. So one man said, my wife does. How to define a word? How to define a neighbor? It was a very difficult question. How to define a neighbor? So this man asked a petty question. Who my neighbor? Who is my neighbor? It's not very difficult for this scholar to know. He was a very intellectual person. I was trying to decipher why this man was finding it difficult to understand a simple word, neighbor. He was a scholar, so he wanted to understand that word in a scholarly way. He didn't want to have a literal meaning of that Greek word neighbor. He wanted to have a scholarly, a philosophic, a religious interpretation of that word neighbor. So yesterday I was going through the Bible, and in the Old Testament, this word neighbor is found 119 times out of 135 in the whole Bible. So this word is found only 16 times in the New Testament. In the Old Testament, this word is found 119 times. So this scholar, he must have been a scribe, a priest. He must have read the Bible passage very thoroughly, and he must have come across that word at least 119 times. As a Levite, he must have loved the books of Leviticus, and the book of Leviticus has got this word neighbor 13 times. Now he quoted from Leviticus 19 verse 18, love your neighbor as thyself. In that Leviticus, in that passage alone, the word neighbor is found 5 times. So this word is found all over in the Bible, so it's not a very difficult thing for him to understand, but he asked this petty question, who is my neighbor? There's a reason for that, I'll show you. We go to Leviticus 19:18. There it says, thou shalt not avenge nor bear any grudge against the children of thy people, but thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. I am the Lord. Listen, in the first part, thou shalt not bear any grudge against the children of thy people. In the second part, but, the conjunction is but. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Who is my neighbor? My people? All Israelites? Do I include Samaritans? Are only Jews? The tribe of Benjamin and Judah? Who is my people? All Israelites? Then the 10 tribes are lost. Should I love those 10 tribes? Who are my people? Only the Jews, or Jews and Benjamins? In the days of Saul, David, Saul was against David like an enemy. So the Benjamites and the people of Judah, they were enmity. Are they one people or two people? Who are my people? Only my family? Who are my people? So they were unable to understand this part. This word neighbor and thy people. Thy people. So who are thy people? How can I love all Israelites? 10 tribes are lost. Only these 2 tribes, Benjamin and Judah, they were at loggerheads at one point of time. Now what shall I do? Who is my people? Only the family of David? My dear brother, my dear sister, for that only Jesus told him that story. And Jesus answering said, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho. It was not a parable. Please, Sunday school teachers and the preachers, please listen. Don't say it's a parable. Don't include this in the list of parables. It's not a parable. It's something that really happened. There we read about a certain lawyer. Here we are reading about a certain man. We are reading about a certain man. It's not a just an illustration. Jesus talked about a man who went down from Jerusalem to Jericho. He might be a Jew. From Jerusalem to Jericho, it was about 24 kilometers. Jerusalem is a hill city, Jericho is a plain, so it is from Jerusalem we should go down to Jericho. This man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho. Probably he was a priest or a Levite, maybe a Jew. After doing a service in the temple as a priest or as a Levite, probably after worshipping the Lord in Jerusalem, he is going back to Jericho. In those days, about 120,000, 120,000 priests and Levites were living in Jericho. I just read that in one record. About 120,000 priests and Levites were living in Jericho. People going from Jericho to Jerusalem, coming down from Jerusalem to Jericho is an ordinary thing. And I got a small suspicion in mind. I'll tell you later. So this man was coming down from Jerusalem to Jericho, fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiments. The original says raiments. He was left stark naked. Stripped him of his raiments. They robbed him. Why did they strip him of his raiment? I don't know. But there is a reason for it. Wounded him and departed, leaving him half dead. Leaving him half dead. And please listen, by chance. It's by chance. You should understand in the right perception, it so happened. By chance of God. It so happened. God planned it like that. It is not perfect will of God. It so happened. By chance, there came down a certain priest that way. So here we see the priest is also from Jerusalem to Jericho. This is very clear. So some people said he didn't want to touch that man because a priest should not be defiled by a dead body, then he cannot minister to God. But the Bible is very careful. Number one, that man was not dead. When the Bible says he is half dead, he is half alive. He was half alive. That man was not dead. Touching him will not make a priest defiled. Number two, the priest was not going to Jerusalem to do the service. The priest was coming down from Jerusalem. So he has accomplished probably his service to the Lord. He did his service to the Lord, but service to the man he didn't mind. So this man was coming down from Jerusalem, saw him, he passed by on the other side. And likewise the Levite, when he was at the place, I don't know whether he was going up or he was coming down, and looked on that victim, and passed by on the other side. And a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was. I don't know whether he was going to Jerusalem or he was coming down from Jerusalem. He came where this victim was, and when he saw him, he had compassion on him and went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring in oil and wine, and set him on his own beast, and brought him to an inn, and took care of him. So what he did? Set him on his own beast, and brought him to an inn, and took care of him. And on the matter, when he departed, he took out 2 pence. This is just a 2 days' labor, about 1,500 or 2,000 rupees. Probably he needed money for his own business. Or rather, very interestingly, he gave a promise and told that host, take care of him, and whatsoever you spend more, when I come again, he would come again, and he would, and I would repay you. I would repay you. My dear brother, my dear sister, I said, I got one doubt. I may be right. I want to be right. One of those 3 men, the priest or the Levite or the wounded Jew, probably one of these 3 men might have been this lawyer. Jesus told him this instant. Probably Jesus heard about it, or supernaturally Jesus knew it, I don't know. Jesus talked to him about this instant. Probably this man was aware of this instant. This man was aware of this instant. Probably that priest was this lawyer. So when Jesus was telling this story, this man might have been wriggling with him. He was that priest who went by the side. He did service to the Lord. A very devout person. He wanted to love his neighbor. He knew his neighbor was a Jew. But he didn't know whether it was a priest or a Levite or an ordinary Jew. Who is his neighbor? But now Jesus is telling a story about a priest, but his heart was not condemned. I'll explain that later. A Jew thought, a priest thought, anyone other than his own people suffering is God's punishment. Ho ho! They all died because they worshipped a wrong God. It is God's wrath on them because they went to worship a wrong God. That is how they understood the religion. This man was attacked by robbers. This man was waylaid. This man was left stark naked. This man was wounded, left half dead. Why? Because it's a punishment from God. If it is a stranger, you need not help him. When God has punished him, why should I help him? If something amiss has taken place to a stranger, it is God's punishment. Same thing happens to our own people. Oh, it is duty for us to love them. That is the mindset of the people. So probably he was a priest. He said, no, why God has punished him? I don't know, he may be a Samaritan or a Jew, because this man was left stark naked. He is wearing a priestly garment. This priest might have known, oh, he is my fellow priest. If he is wearing a garment of a Levite, oh, he is a Levite, this fellow was assisting me. If he was wearing at least a garment of a Jew, oh, he is my brother, I should help. Now this man was stark naked. My dear brother, my dear sister, we don't know whether he is a Jew, whether he is a Samaritan. What makes a difference? What makes a difference? It is our outward appearance. It is our outward appearance. Is the difference brought because we take the Holy Communion, the wine, and somebody is taking the Tirtham? Is that the difference between a Christian and a non-Christian? You take the wine, he takes the Tirtham. Does that make the difference? You take the holy bread, he takes the prasadam. Does that make the difference? You have got a cross, he has got a spear or a trishul. Does that make the difference? Now we don't know who is this man, whether a Jew or a Samaritan. He was lying stark naked. My dear brother, my dear sister, what this man had, only two things. He had compassion on somebody's suffering. That compassion resulted in taking care of him. That compassion resulted taking care of him. With love and affection, I tell you, baptism alone doesn't make us Christians. Wearing a cross or putting a cross doesn't make us a Christian. Just having a sip of grape juice and eating a pinch of bread doesn't make us Christians. Going to a Christian worship place doesn't make us a Christian. It is something more than that. When you take baptism, he take a holy dip in a holy waters. When you want to carry a cross, he wants to carry a trishul. When you take wine, he wants to take tirtham. Please don't get offended. I'm comparing these two things. I want to tell you, these things don't make us Christians. It is loving God and loving man. This man had compassion for somebody who is suffering. His compassion was encashed to his caring nature. I don't have time to explain what all the ways he cared. My dear brother, my dear sister, now Jesus asked this pivotal question. Tell me now, of these three, thinkest thou which was neighbor unto him that fell among the thieves? This man didn't want to say the Samaritan. The Samaritans are untouchable to these Jews. He didn't want to say the Samaritan was the neighbor. He always thought a Jew was a neighbor. He didn't want to say a Samaritan was a neighbor. Probably Jesus used the word Samaritan because the Jews were calling Jesus a Samaritan. We read in John 8, they said, "It is true that we call you a Samaritan." Jesus didn't say, "No, I am not a Samaritan." So Jesus is talking about that Samaritan. You call me a Samaritan, but who is your neighbor? Jesus didn't give him the answer. Who is your neighbor? Jesus said, go and do thou likewise. Don't ask a question, who is my neighbor? Be a neighbor to somebody who is in need. Don't ask a question, who is my neighbor? Be a neighbor to somebody who is in need. My dear brother, my dear sister, so in loving neighbor, don't ask a question to whom I should love. Be a neighbor to somebody who is in need. Very quickly, I'm going to give you five categories whom you should love. Number one, be a neighbor to your family, to your own mother, to your own father, to your own brothers, sisters. Somebody is in need. Be a neighbor to them. Don't ask a question whether they loved you or not. Don't ask a question whether they are your neighbors or not. Be a neighbor to them. Be a neighbor to them. That day I phoned one auto driver. There was a ringtone in his phone, and maybe a semi-dialogue, but the dialogue was like this: one who bears the child in the womb for 10 months is the mother. One who bears the mother in the heart for the life is the child. One who bears the child in the womb for 10 months is the mother. One who bears the mother in the heart for the life is the son. And it went one more statement, a very powerful statement. If you eat rice sorry. If you eat rice without giving to your food, without giving to your mother, what you are eating is not rice, it's something else. Charity begins at home. Love your own family members. Love your own sister. Whether that person is worthy of your love or not, love your own parents. My dear brother, I am fighting against time, but I just say this one important thing and conclude. It really happened. A father first took his wife and a man first took his wife and son, ran away with somebody else. This mother, with all her sufferings, worked as a laborer in many places, carrying the mud, carrying the sand, carrying the brick, working in other houses. She was bringing up this boy. He became a good officer, gazetted officer. She also passed away. By the time that lady first took her father and that man was left alone, nobody to take care of him, became very old, very sick. Went back to the son was not willing to take him back because he first took his mother and him. This matter went to the court in a magistrate level. That time that magistrate well known to us, my brother was in his house. Later he became a high court judge. So this magistrate called this officer and talked to him. Okay, ma, forget everything, take care of your father. No, this is what he did to my mother, this is what he did to me, now I don't care for him. This magistrate with love and affection pleaded, but the officer was adamant. So this magistrate asked, my brother was there in the house. So this magistrate asked him a question, what's your name? No, I forgot the name of the man. Just say, Yes Kumar. What is your name? Yes Kumar. What is this yes? Yes Shankar, my father. He said, Dey, in the yes matra vanakillana, unga amma purushan per theriyadha vanda. Appan theriyadha pullada ni. You are an illegitimate child. To brought honor to you and to your mother was this one letter yes. For using this letter yes for all these years, now you have to take care of your father for the rest of his life. For using this one letter yes, that only brought honor to you and to your mother. My dear brother, my dear sister, forget what they have done, what they haven't done. Love your family members. Number two, love your well-wishers. So many people work for your good. Your brother, your sister, your teacher, your friend, your relative. They have done something that you could come up in life. Whatever it may be, love them in turn. And number three, love your friends, your colleagues. You know them, they know you. Love them. And number three, to your vicinage, anyone you see, whether you know him or not, whether he is your well-wisher or not, this is exactly what he said, be a neighbor. Somebody in need, somebody is suffering in Uttarakhand, try to do something. Somebody is suffering in your office, somebody in your neighborhood, in your vicinage, when you know somebody is in need, be there indeed. And finally, to be a Christian, even be a neighbor to your enemies. After all, the matrix of life is love God and love man. Love God, love man. Abu Ben Adam, may his tribe increase. Awoke one night from a deep dream of peace and saw within the moonlight in his room, making it rich and like a lily in blue, an angel writing in a book of gold. exceeding peace had made when Adam bold, and to the presence in the room he said, "What writest thou?" The vision raised his head, and with a look made of all sweet accord, answered the names of those who love the Lord. And his mind won, said Abu. "Nay, not so," replied the angel. Abu spoke more low, but cheerily still, and said, "I pray thee, then, write me as one that love his fellow men." The angel wrote and vanished. The next night, it came again with a great awakening light and showed the names which love of God had blessed. And lo, Ben-Adam's name led all the rest. Love God, love man, eternal life is yours. God bless you. Shall we close our eyes? Ask God's grace. At least think this twice a day. Pray this prayer. Lord, give me a heart to love you with all my strength, with all my mind, with all my soul, with all my heart. Give me a heart to have compassion for somebody who is in need, and to take care of you. Brother, sister, start that in your house. Help somebody who is in need. Help your mother-in-law. Help your daughter-in-law. Help your father-in-law. Help your old parents. Help your sisters, your brothers. Help someone who is in need. Help someone who is in the vicinage. Even be a neighbor to your enemy.